Aunt Yalila, Chapter 5. All glories to Lord Gaurasundar, the spiritual preceptor of the entire universe. You are the desire tree for all the surrendered devotees. All glories to you, who are the most brilliant gem of the sannyas order, the Lord of Vaikuntha. Please bless the living entities with your merciful glance. All glories to the Supreme Lord Gauranga, and to all his devotees and associates. You are the most munificent Lord, an ocean of divine compassion. Now please hear attentively the narrations of the Lord's pastimes recorded in the concluding portion of this book. After staying another few days in Sri Advaita's house, the Lord went to Kumarahat, to the house of Srivas Pandit. When the Lord arrived, he found Srivas Pandit absorbed in meditation on Lord Krishna. Seeing Lord Gaurasundar, the Lord of his life, appearing before him in person, Srivas felt as though the object of his meditation had materialized as a result of his deep and sincere meditation. Srivas Pandit threw himself on the ground like a stick and paid his respects to the Lord. He clasped the Lord's lotus feet to his chest, and sighing deeply, he shed profuse tears of love. The Lord picked him up and embraced him, drenching him with tears of divine love. Srivas Pandit's entire family was blessed by the Lord's causeless mercy. They all rushed to see the Lord, and raising their arms in overwhelming joy, they began to weep. Srivas Pandit was overwhelmed with happiness. He could not fathom the exhilaration he experienced having the Lord of Vaikuntha as a guest in his house. He placed his best seat on his head and brought it to the Lord. The lotus-eyed Gauranga sat down. The devotees surrounded him and began kirtan. The ladies of the house made auspicious sounds to welcome the Lord. Srivas Pandit's home resounded with joy. The news of the Lord's arrival in Srivas Pandit's house spread quickly. Acharya Purandara came immediately to meet him. The Lord embraced him with affection and reverence, considering him to be his father. Acharya Purandara was overwhelmed with spiritual emotion and could not hold back his tears of extreme joy as he embraced the Lord. Sri Vasudev Dat and Sri Shivananda Sain and his relatives came running to see the Lord. Sri Vasudev Dat was very dear to the Lord. By the Lord's grace, he knew all of the esoteric conclusions of the scriptures. He was always meditating on how to benefit the living entities. He was compassionate to everyone and always absorbed in thoughts of Lord Chaitanya. He never looked for faults in others, but always praised their good qualities. He had great attraction and love for the Supreme Lord and his service. He was always respectful to the Vaishnavas and rendered humble service to them. The Lord was very pleased to see Sri Vasudev Dat, and he embraced him, weeping profusely. Sri Vasudev fell to the ground and clasped the Lord's lotus feet, crying loudly. He cried so piteously that even the stones were moved to tears. He was endowed with such wonderful qualities that only he alone could exemplify such qualities. The Lord loved Sri Vasudev so dearly that he said, "It is indeed true that I belong to Vasudev." Repeatedly the Lord said, "My body is Vasudev's property. He can sell me anywhere he wants." This is true and not meaning anything else. A moment's association with Sri Vasudev can bless anyone with Lord Krishna's protection from all dangers. O Vaishnava devotees, please hear me. I say truly that Sri Vasudev owns me completely. The devotees became jubilant, hearing the Lord shower such causeless mercy on Sri Vasudev, and loudly chanted the holy name. Lord Gaurasundar is expert in praising his devotees and increasing their glories. Just as the devotees are always eulogizing the Lord's transcendental qualities, the Lord also does so in the same manner. The Lord stayed for some time in Srivas Pandit's house performing exhilarating pastimes. Shivas Pandit and his brother Ramai Pandit were always engaged in singing the glories of the Lord, and the Lord, feeling spiritually animated by their singing, danced in ecstasy. Both the brothers, Shrivas Pandit and Ramai Pandit, are very beloved of the Lord. They are like the two bodies of the Lord. Shrivas Pandit pleased the Lord in many ways by performing kirtan, discussing from the Srimad Bhagavatam, and maintaining proper standards of Vaishnava etiquette. It was in Shrivas Pandit's house that the Lord performed some of his most wonderful pastimes. One day, the Lord called Shrivas Pandit aside and asked him confidentially about some family matters. The Lord said, "I see you never go anywhere. How will you manage to make ends meet in the family, and how are you doing it presently?" Shrivas Pandit replied, "My Lord, I have not the heart to go anywhere." The Lord gently prodded the subject further. "You have a large family to maintain. How then will you look after them?" Shrivas Pandit said, "Whatever comes because of my fate will certainly come as a provision." The Lord then said, "Then Shrivas, take sannyas." Shrivas replied, "That is not possible for me." The Lord said, "On one hand, you refuse to accept sannyas, and on the other hand, you do not go out to beg alms. How do you plan to maintain your family? I am unable to understand you. Nowadays, if one does not make the effort of going hither and thither, then nothing comes of its own. Under the circumstances, please tell me, what do you propose to do?" Shrivas Pandit said, clapping his hands thrice, "Here is my explanation. 1, 2, 3. The Lord insisted, "Please explain properly why you clapped thrice, and what does 1, 2, 3 imply?" Shrivas Pandit replied calmly, "I have taken a solemn vow that if after fasting for 3 meals I do not get any food, then I will surely tie a stone around my neck and drown myself in the Ganga." As soon as the Lord heard these words, he roared like thunder and said, "What did you say, Shrivas Pandit? You will be fasting because of lack of food? Even if Lakshmi Devi by some rare chance has to go begging, your family will never experience poverty. Shrivas Pandit, you have already forgotten what I have said in the Bhagavad Gita. Those who worship me with devotion, meditating on my transcendental form, to them I carry what they lack and preserve what they have. One who is fixed in undeviating meditation on me has never to beg at anyone's steps. All the mystic potencies automatically manifest in him. My devotees are fully protected by my Sudarshan disc at all times. And even at the time of total annihilation of this material universe, they remain transcendental and unaffected." The Lord continued, "One who simply remembers my devotee, I take responsibility of maintaining him. The servitor of my servitor is dear to me, and he certainly attains my shelter. My servitors need not have any concern about their maintenance, since I am taking their responsibility on my shoulders. So, Shrivas Pandit, you just maintain happily in your house, and every requirement will automatically come to you. I am blessing you and Sri Advaita with the boon that none of you will ever be affected by old age, debility, or senility." The Lord then called for Ramai Pandit and told him, "Listen, Ramai Pandit, I instruct you to always serve your elder brother as if he were the Supreme Lord. Know also that you are as dear to me as my very life, so I want that you never deviate from this service to Shrivas Pandit." Both Shrivas Pandit and Ramai Pandit were overwhelmed with divine bliss. The blessed Lord had filled their hearts with indescribable joy. By Lord Chaitanya's causeless mercy, even now, in some pastime, all requirements are coming on their own to Shrivas Pandit's doorsteps. The Lord remained a few days more in Shrivas Pandit's house, enjoying his stay in the company of his associates and the affectionate family members of Shrivas Pandit. From there, he went to Sri Raghava Pandit's house in Panihati. Sri Raghava Pandit was always busy in serving Lord Krishna. So when the Lord arrived, Sri Raghava Pandit was overwhelmed to see his beloved Lord face to face. He fell to the ground offering obeisances and clasped his lotus feet, the very same lotus feet that are the source of Lakshmi Devi's constant joy. He began to weep in jubilation. The Lord was also extremely happy to see his dear devotee, and he picked him up and embraced him, while unrestrained tears of joy bathed Raghava Pandit. Sri Raghava Pandit did not know what to do or how to receive the Lord. Such was his effusive bliss. The Lord of Vaikuntha, Sri Chaitanya, was very pleased with Srila Raghava Pandit's devotion, and he showered his mercy upon him. The Lord said, "By coming to Raghava Pandit's house and seeing him, all my gloom has been dispelled." Coming to his house has resulted in the same purification and hence satisfaction as bathing in the holy Ganga. Then smiling benignly at Srila Raghava Pandit, the Lord said to him, "Dear Raghava Pandit, please go immediately and prepare food for Lord Krishna's satisfaction." Raghava Pandit immediately went off swimming in ecstasy to execute the Lord's order. His heart inundated with divine love, he cooked, as his heart dictated, a plentiful variety. The Lord came to eat, accompanied by Nityananda Prabhu and all the associates. The Lord relished Srila Raghava Pandit's cooking and praised each and every preparation. The Lord said to Raghava Pandit, "Raghava Pandit has cooked everything so excellently well. Especially, I have never tasted such a delectable preparation of spinach, shak, ever before." Raghava Pandit already knew that the Lord was very fond of shak, so he made it a point to prepare it in many delicious ways. The Lord, finishing his food, washed and came and sat down. Meanwhile, word had spread that the Lord was staying in Srila Raghava Pandit's house. Sri Gadadhar Das heard the news and came hastily to meet the Lord. Srila Gadadhar Das was very near and dear to the Lord. He epitomized pure devotion to the Lord. The Lord was extremely pleased to see Gadadhar Das, and out of great love for him, he placed his lotus feet on his head. Sri Purandara Pandit and Srila Parameshwari Das also came rushing to see the Lord. Parameshwari Das was so surrendered to the Lord that the Lord reciprocated and manifest himself in person in his deity. Both these saintly devotees were in great ecstasy to see the Lord, and they cried tears of divine love. Srila Raghunath Vaidya, that very exalted Vaishnav, also came to meet the Lord. In this way, an endless stream of devotees came to see the Lord. Panihati village experienced an extraordinary spiritual event by the Lord's advent and stay there. The Lord inundated the whole village with divine ecstasy by his personal presence. Once the Lord called Srila Raghava Pandit aside and spoke to him alone. He said, "Raghava, I want to reveal to you confidentially that Nityananda Prabhu is non-different from myself. You must understand that whatever Nityananda wants of me, I do it. Without sophistry, I say that everything I do is through Nityananda. We are one and the same. That which is rarely attained by great mystics steeped in meditation is easily obtained from Lord Nityananda. Therefore, engage yourself with sincerity and deference in Nityananda's service, knowing him to be the Supreme Lord." Before leaving the fortunate village of Panihati, the Lord instructed Makaradwaj, "Serve Raghava Pandit nicely. Know that the loving attachment you have developed for him is highly appreciated by me." The Lord then came to a place called Varaha Nagara. He visited the residence of an exalted and saintly Brahmin. The Brahmin was well versed in the Srimad Bhagavatam, and upon having the Lord's audience, he began to recite the verses. As the Lord heard the verses from Srimad Bhagavatam read by him with sublime devotion, he went into an ecstatic trance. With a voice resembling the roll of thunder, he cried out, "Read on, read on." The pious Brahmin was blissfully submerged in the text, reading aloud, and the Lord began to dance in divine exaltation, oblivious to everything around him. Verse after verse described the transcendental glory of loving devotional surrender, and the Lord swooned again and again, falling like a rod on the ground with tremendous force. Such was the Lord's spiritual ecstasy that the people were amazed and afraid to see him fall with such intensity. This pastime lasted late into the night. The Brahmin read, and the Lord danced. Gradually, the Lord came out of his ecstatic trance, and he calmly sat down. He was extremely happy with the Brahmin, and so he embraced him. The Lord said to him, "I have never heard anyone reciting the Srimad Bhagavatam so sweetly. Therefore, I name you Bhagavat Acharya, or the spiritual preceptor of the Bhagavatam. You need not engage in any other activity. Just go on reciting the Bhagavatam." Everyone was jubilant with the Brahmin's new and deserving title. they appreciated it with loud chanting of the Lord's name. Blessing the residents of that place, the Lord traveled along the banks of the Ganga, visiting many houses of devotees. He satisfied all the devotees, fulfilling their hearts yearning to see him. Finally, he returned to Nilachala, Puri. One who hears these descriptions of the Lord's return to Bengal becomes immediately free from all distresses. Great crowds of people greeted the Lord as he entered Jagannath Puri with jubilant sounds, saying, "The moving Lord Jagannath has come back to Nilachala." The news flashed with the speed of lightning everywhere. Sri Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya and the other Aryan associates of the Lord came running to see him. The devotees were morose because of feelings of separation since the Lord was away, and now, on his return, they were exulting and welcomed him with loud kirtan. The Lord, the reservoir of divine love, embraced them, reciprocating their spiritual affections, and bathed everyone with his effusive tears. Once in Nilachala, he began to reside in Kashi Mishra's house. Here in Puri, the Lord spent all his time dancing in ecstasy and performing sweet, sublime kirtans everywhere. Often he danced before Lord Jagannath, losing himself in the ecstatic, graceful movements, sometimes within the closed precincts of Kashi Mishra's residence, and at other times he simply ran out to the ocean shores and danced to the rhythmic crashing of the waves on the sand. Blissfully oblivious of every other activity, the Lord now engaged in this wonderful pastime. He was up early with the first blowing of the conch shell from the temple, and as the doors to Lord Jagannath opened, he was there, bowing before the Lord. So wonderful was his love for Lord Jagannath that tears cascaded from his eyes and flowed like the river Ganga. All the people stared, transfixed in amazement, their worries and sorrows long forgotten. Crowds followed him wherever he went. They were moved and inspired. Loudly they chanted, "Hari, Hari," as they went behind the Lord's dancing form. The king of Orissa, Maharaj Prataparudra, also heard the news of the Lord's return to Nilachala. He immediately left the capital, Cuttack, and hurried to Nilachala, Puri. The king was very keen to see the Lord and meet him, and had been trying since long without success. He had requested many of the Lord's associates, including Sri Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya, to approach the Lord on his behalf, but all of them were afraid to approach him on this matter. So thinking, he said, exasperated, to Sri Sarvabhauma, "If you are afraid to speak to him about me, then at least point him out to me without him seeing me." Appreciating the king's intense desire to see the Lord, the devotees decided to help him. They conferred and said, "The Lord becomes totally absorbed while dancing, and the external world fades into oblivion from his consciousness. At that time, the king, who is so deeply religious, can see the Lord from his place of hiding." The devotees explained their plan to the king, and the king eagerly responded, saying, "I just want to see him once by any means." So one day the king was informed that the Lord was dancing, and he hurried to the spot. He quickly found a vantage point that was well hidden. From there, he saw the most wonderful sight of his life. The Lord's eyes were like two river sources, spouting unlimited tears like waterfalls, and all the ecstatic symptoms manifested on his person at different times. He sometimes fell to the ground with such terrible force that people gasped in horrified alarm. When the Lord began his roaring like thunderclaps, the king had to hold his hands over his ears. Then suddenly the Lord would be overcome with the mood of intense separation from Krishna and break down in heartbreaking tears. So many subtle spiritual moods played on the Lord's person that it is impossible for anyone to describe. Dancing constantly with his long arms up in the air and chanting Hari, Hari, the Lord was fully saturated in ecstasy. Finally, when he became aware of his immediate surroundings, he came and sat down amongst the devotees. The king, after seeing the Lord's dancing till the end, stealthily slipped away, his heart full with effervescent joy, his inner eye still viewing the graceful movements of the Lord. Though the king was fully satisfied, his mind was stuck with a gnawing doubt, which later turned out to be a blessing in disguise. When the Lord was submerged in dancing, tears cascaded down from his eyes, and saliva drooled out of his mouth and nose in the acme of divine ecstasy. His body was smeared all over with drool and dust, and the king could not comprehend that these were symptoms of spiritual love for the Supreme Lord Krishna. Doubt crept into his mind, but without revealing this to anyone, he went away feeling happy and content. On returning home, he went to rest for the night. The king had failed to understand, even after the day's experience, that his worshipable Lord Jagannath had appeared dancing before him, incarnated as Lord Chaitanya, the topmost sannyasi. So the Lord himself set about to communicate this truth to the king. That night, the pious King Prataparudra saw Lord Jagannath appear in his dreams. He saw that Lord Jagannath's body was covered with dust. His eyes, like torrential springs, gushed out incessant tears. Drool was dropping out of his mouth and nose, wetting his body and making it gleam. In the dream, the king thought to himself, "What kind of pastime is this? All these activities of Lord Jagannath are incomprehensible to me." The king approached his beloved lord to touch his lotus feet, and Lord Jagannath said, "No, no, this is not proper. When I am smeared with camphor, musk, sandalwood paste, vermilion, and other perfumed oils, then I am the most desirable and clean. But see now, my body is covered with dust and drool, and I am not fit to be touched by you. Today you came to see me dancing, and when I was covered in dust and drool, you found me repulsive. Now that I am in that same dirty condition, how can you think that now I am clean enough to be touched by one who is a great monarch with an illustrious ancestry?" Speaking in this manner, Lord Jagannath, the most merciful Lord, smiled at his servitor. The next moment, the king saw, still in the dream, that Lord Jagannath was no longer seated on the throne. The new occupant of the throne was Lord Chaitanya. His body was covered with dust, and smilingly he spoke to the king. "How can this be possible? Today you went away, having found me repugnant. Then why do you want to touch me now?" After the Lord finished speaking, he continued to smile benignly upon the king, thus showering unlimited mercy on him. On awakening after a while, the king began to weep bitterly and condemned himself for his act. He repented. "I am the most sinful wretch alive. I could not recognize that Lord Chaitanya was the Supreme Lord. Of course, how much intelligence does a human possess to understand the infinite truth on his own? Even Lord Brahma is deluded by his illusory potency, Maya. Therefore, my Lord, be gracious on me. Forgive me for my offensive behavior. Accept me, a lowly person, as your servant, and bless me." Then the king realized that his worshipable deity, Lord Jagannath, was in fact Lord Chaitanya. With this realization, his yearning to meet the Lord increased manyfold. Yet none of the Lord's associates could arrange a rendezvous with the Lord. Soon after this incident, one day, the Lord was sitting in a garden surrounded by all his devotees. Mustering up courage, alone he approached the group and fell flat at the Lord's lotus feet. Immediately, the king was heaved high on waves of ecstasy. Shivering, weeping, and horripilation all manifested on his person. The Lord, seeing that the king was indeed imbued with the spiritual sentiments of a Vaishnav, placed his hands on him and said, "Rise, O king." The touch of the Supreme Master's hand on him brought him out of his ecstatic trance, and he clasped his hands around the Lord's feet and began to cry. The king began to pray to the Lord, "Save me, O Lord, save me. You are an ocean of mercy and the Lord of all living entities. Please look upon me favorably and forgive a fallen sinner like me. You are the fully independent Supreme Lord, most munificent. O Lord Chaitanya, you are the friend of the poor and meek. Please protect me, for you are eulogized with chosen verses by all the most powerful demigods. You are the husband of the goddess of fortune, Lakshmi Devi. You are the only shelter and Lord of all surrendered souls. Your form is absolutely transcendental to all material inebriety. You are the initiator of the congregational chanting, fearlessly propagating it. For you are the conqueror of the terrible demon Mura. Your transcendental qualities and names are all unfathomable, and you are the repository of all supermundane excellences. Your lotus feet are constantly worshipped and glorified by Lord Shiva, Lord Brahma, Lord Shesha, Sri Devi, and others. You are also the priceless gem amongst all the sannyasis. O Lord Gaurasundar, I bow humbly before you with this prayer, that you may never reject me and deprive me of your sublime shelter." Lord Chaitanya was very satisfied with King Prataparudra's prayers. He blessed him, saying, "May you develop an unalloyed taste for serving Lord Krishna. Do not engage in any other activity except to render devotional service to Lord Krishna. Go and perform continuous chanting of the holy name, and you will always be protected by the Lord's Sudarshan disc. My reason for coming to Nilachala was to meet the three of you, Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya and Ramananda Roy. There is just one request of mine I want you to keep. That is not to broadcast about me. If you do so, then I will leave right away." Saying this, he lifted the flower garland adorning his neck and placed it around the king. The Lord bade him farewell, feeling very satisfied with him. Offering repeated dandavats to the Lord, the king left, taking seriously to heart the Lord's instruction to him. The king's mission was complete. He had seen and met the Lord. From then on, he was always engrossed in meditation on the Lord's lotus feet. One who hears this narration of how King Prataparudra met Lord Gaurasundar is guaranteed to receive divine love of Godhead. The Lord's pastimes in Nilachala are numerous, and he enjoyed his own activities. The Lord's eternal associates who appeared in Nilachala all spontaneously recognized Lord Chaitanya as the Lord of their heart. Sri Pradyumna Mishra is an ocean of love for Krishna. Lord Chaitanya personally gave him shelter at his lotus feet. Then there is Sri Paramananda Mahapatra, who is an embodiment of nectarian love for Lord Chaitanya. Sri Kashi Mishra was always in a state of divine ecstasy, relishing the sublime nectar of Krishna Prem. The Lord stayed in his house. The Lord spent most of his time in congregational chanting in the company of these servitors. Most of the Lord's followers who had developed disinterest to continue in family life all came to stay in Nilachala. Lord Nityananda spent a long time in Nilachala. He was always enthusiastic, jubilant, and roamed everywhere in Nilachala. Like the noon sun, he was perennially saturated and intoxicated with divine love. I am incapable of writing fully about his unlimited ecstatic love. He is always chanting just one name, Sri Krishna Chaitanya. No other name escaped his lips, even in a dream. Just like Sri Lakshman was completely devoted to Lord Ramachandra, so is Nitai fully surrendered in his love for Lord Chaitanya. The reason for the whole world glorifying Lord Chaitanya even today is solely due to Lord Nityananda's mercy. In this way, the two brothers, Lord Chaitanya and Nityananda Prabhu, passed their days in Nilachala. One day, Lord Gaurasundar, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, now appeared in human form, was sitting in a secluded place conversing with Lord Nityananda. The Lord said to Nityananda Prabhu, "O Exalted One, dear Nityananda, please listen. You must return to Navadvip immediately. In my own words, I have promised, I will drown every ignorant, wretched, and fallen soul in the deluge of Krishna Prema. But now, if you also take to the life of a hermit, discarding your indomitable enthusiasm, then who will deliver these fallen souls? You are the storehouse of devotional mellows, distributing divine love to everyone. Now, if you withdraw within yourself from these activities, then what was the necessity of your appearance on this planet? If you want my opinion, then I think you should go immediately to Bengal and relieve the sufferings of the conditioned souls by showering them with a mood of devotional service." On receiving these instructions from the Lord, Nityananda Prabhu started for Bengal with all his devotee associates. These elevated souls were Ramdas Gadadhar Das, Raghunath Vaidya, Krishnadas Pandit, Parameshwari Das, and Purandara Pandit. On the way, Lord Nityananda was the first to become overcome with spiritual ecstasy. This spiritual mood infected all the other associates. They were filled with wonderment, seeing Lord Nityananda. Soon, they were also experiencing unlimited divine bliss. Ramdas, a stalwart amongst the Vaishnavas, was imbued with the spiritual mood of the Supreme Lord Krishna himself. Right in the middle of the road, he stood like Gopal, bent in three places for almost an hour, oblivious of his surroundings. Gadadhar Das was overcome with the mood of Srimati Radharani. Laughing in sweet peals, he said, Who wants to buy yogurt? Raghunath Vaidya was draped in the sublime personality of Mother Revati. Parameshwari Das and Krishna Das were both experiencing the mood of Gopal and the cowherd boys. They began to make sounds with their mouths when herding the cows. Purandara Pandit had climbed up a tree. Shouting, he said, "I am Angada," and jumped down in a leap from the branch. Lord Nityananda had infused in everyone's heart the ecstatic experiences of exhilarating spiritual moods. They traveled like this for a few miles, sometimes going to the left and sometimes to the right without any direction. After a while, they asked the local people, "Please tell us how we can reach the Ganga." They replied, "Oh, you have already come too far. You must go back a distance of 2 hours." They changed direction according to the direction of the locals and traveled for a while in the right direction. But again, after some distance, they got aimlessly lost in their mood of ecstasy. They had to stop someone and ask again for proper direction. Again, one of them pointed out, "You have to travel another 20 miles to the left." Realizing their confusion, they laughed, looking at each other, and embarked once more on their journey. They had forgotten the existence of their own bodies, what to speak about remembering the right direction. Unconcerned about the needs of the body, like thirst, hunger, fear, and suffering, they were always experiencing great joy. Who can describe the transcendental activities of Lord Nityananda as he traveled? Because they are inexhaustible. Finally, they arrived at Panihati village on the banks of the river Ganga. Lord Nityananda went first to Sri Raghava Pandit's house and put up there with all his devotees. Both Raghava Pandit and Sri Makaradwaj Khan and their families were very happy to receive their most exalted guests. The guests remained there for a few days. In that wonderful atmosphere, Lord Nityananda and his devotees felt always spiritually exhilarated. Every once in a while, Lord Nityananda would roar out his appreciation. Once he felt strongly within himself the spiritual urge to dance. Suddenly, all the singers began appearing there. Sri Madhava Ghosh, the famous kirtan singer, came. His kirtan singing was the best in the whole world. He was known as the singer from Vrindavan because he was especially expert in singing about the Lord's pastimes in Vrindavan, which were Lord Nityananda's favorite kirtans. Lord Nityananda danced with such ecstatic abandon that the earth reeled under his weight. Roaring sounds like thunder incessantly issued from his mouth, and when he fell crashing to the ground, people stood back in amazement. When his merciful glance fell on any person, he was instantaneously infused with divine love of Godhead, and by the power of that love, the recipient also fell to the ground, swooning. Lord Nityananda is the embodiment of the highest spiritual love, and he has advented simply to alleviate the suffering due to ignorance in this world. While dancing, he manifested all the different ecstatic symptoms of divine love. Finally, he sat down on Lord Vishnu's throne and acquiesced to a request to be bathed by the devotees. Sri Raghava Pandit and his other eternal associates immediately made preparations for the Abhishek, or bathing ceremony. They carried in hundreds of pots filled with Ganga water and perfumed it with delicate aromas. The devotees one by one poured water over his head with a gladdened heart, and all the while chanted the Lord's holy name. The devotees chanted appropriate mantras for the Abhishek and felt divine exhilaration surge through their person. After the Abhishek, they clothed him in fresh new clothes, decorated him with sandalwood paste, and covered his full broad chest with garlands of fragrant wild flowers and tulsi leaves. Then they made him sit on the ornate Vishnu throne of shining gold draped with flower garlands and leaves. When Lord Nityananda sat down, Sri Raghava Pandit went behind the throne and held an open umbrella over his head. The whole house now began to reverberate with jubilant sounds of human voices chanting the holy name, mingled with the melody of musical instruments. Lifting their arms and begging the Lord to protect them, the devotees forgot all their cares and worries and even their own bodies. Lord Nityananda, now totally steeped in the ecstasy of his own divine self, glanced all around, emanating love of Godhead from his eyes, and also showered them with merciful drops of tears. He called Raghava Pandit and ordered, "Dear Raghava Pandit, go and bring me right this moment a garland of Kadamba flowers. I am very fond of Kadamba flowers. In fact, I am always attracted to stay in the Kadamba forest." With folded hands, Sri Raghava Pandit replied, "But my lord, this is not the season for kadambas." The lord gently pressed, "Go and look carefully in the garden. Maybe a few can be seen blooming somewhere." Sri Raghava Pandit went outside the house to the garden and was very astonished to see what met his eyes. Fresh and lovely kadamba flowers were blooming gleefully in his lemon tree. The flowers were a beautiful hue and gave out sweet fragrance. In fact, these extraordinary flowers could destroy all the material attachments of anyone looking at them. Sri Raghava Pandit was beside himself with joy as he beheld this supermundane phenomena. He quickly gathered the kadamba flowers and began to deftly string them into a garland, and then brought it before Lord Nityananda. Lord Nityananda was greatly pleased to see the kadamba garland, and he placed it around his neck. The Vaishnavas were intoxicated with the heavenly aroma of the flowers and were fascinated by the miracle. But soon another miracle took place. Suddenly, the whole room was fragrant with a new scent. The delectable fragrance of dona flower filled the air, captivating everyone's mind. Laughing aloud, Lord Nityananda teased, saying, "Tell me, which flower smells like that?" The devotees replied with folded hands, "The air carries the delightful scent of dona." Letting everyone speak first, Lord Nityananda finally revealed to them a great secret. He said with overflowing compassion, "Pay good attention to this very mysterious happening. Lord Chaitanya has come from Nilachala and is present here and now to hear your kirtan. He is laden with dona flower garlands he is wearing around his neck, and he has entered the form of a tree. The scent from these divine garlands has now permeated everywhere. He has come personally from Puri to hear your kirtan and witness your dancing. Therefore, all of you leave everything else aside and just constantly chant the holy names of Krishna. Let the nectar of the wonderful activities of Lord Sri Krishna Chaitanya infuse love of Godhead in you." Revealing thus this transcendental happening, Lord Nityananda began to roar loudly, chanting Hari, Hari. He glanced at everyone, his vision emanating sublime love of Godhead. The devotees, touched by the Lord's infinitely tender glance, were instantaneously transported to a region transcending the mundane plane of physical awareness. Dear readers, please try to comprehend the extraordinary potency of Lord Nityananda, how he inundated the entire planet with the knowledge and taste of devotional service to the Supreme Lord. That super excellent mood of devotional surrender of the damsels of Vrindavan, as is described in the Srimad Bhagavatam, was facilely made available by the mercy of Lord Nityananda to the whole world. Lord Nityananda was sitting on the throne, and all the devotees sang and danced in front of him. Some of the devotees, unable to contain their surging glee, climbed up a tree and began to move on tender branches and twigs, but miraculously did not fall. Others roared thunderously and jumped down from the tree. There were others who circled their arms around a tree trunk and uprooted the whole tree, all the while loudly chanting Hari, Hari. Some became surcharged with such immense spiritual strength that they ran to the nearby rows of betel nut trees and, putting their arms around a few of them, uprooted them all at once like a bunch of grass. Lord Nityananda's extraordinary potency to infuse the devotees with blissful love of Godhead was so dynamic that their bodies began manifesting all the ecstatic symptoms of love of Godhead as described in the Srimad Bhagavatam, like crying, shivering, being paralyzed, perspiring profusely, horripilation, roaring, hoarseness, turning pale, and so on. Wherever Lord Nityananda glanced, he saw everyone being showered by the nectarian rain of devotional ecstasy. As his transcendental glance rested on any devotee, he was instantaneously injected with divine love, and swooning, that devotee fell to the ground unaware of the loss of his clothing. Magnetically drawn to the Lord's divine person, the devotee stretched out in an attempt to reach him. The Lord, a perfect picture of complacency, remained seated on his throne, smiling benignly. All his main associates became imbued with extraordinary spiritual potency and mystic opulences. They became omniscient. Their every word became true. Their features flowered into Cupid's beautiful attractiveness. Whoever they touched became electrified with spiritual current, thus making them lose any affiliations towards the mundane, even their own bodies. Lord Nityananda spent 3 months in Panihati, performing transcendental pastimes with his associates. The 3 months passed quickly, carrying the devotees in the waves of divine ecstasy. Unconcerned about their physical needs, they sang and danced. Only the Vedas will try to fully describe in detail the activities that went on in Panihati. What Lord Nityananda did in the span of an hour is practically impossible for anyone to narrate exhaustively. Sometimes he danced in a stately manner surrounded by the devotees, and then suddenly he decided to sit on the throne and ordered the devotees to dance before him one by one. During each of the devotees' dance performance, many incidents occurred. The dancing inspired transcendental loving emotions amongst the devotees, drowning them in a deluge of love of Godhead. All the spectator devotees fell swooning in a moment when the ecstasy reached an apex. It looked like a cluster of banana trees being uprooted in a storm. The devotees did as directed by Lord Nityananda. They constantly chanted Lord Chaitanya's glories led by Lord Nityananda. The whole atmosphere was spiritually highly volatile. Whoever came even to simply watch the happening would be so infected with this spiritual mood that they would also become totally involved, oblivious of everything else. Whatever the devotees desired was immediately fulfilled. Thus, the 3 months seemed to fly by without anyone noticing. One day, during these 3 months, Lord Nityananda felt the desire to decorate himself with ornaments and fine dresses. No sooner he felt the urge that fineries were being brought by different people without prior information. All these gifts were very precious and of the best quality. The finest silks, exquisite gold jewelry studded with brilliant gems. The people came with their gifts and offered them to the Lord with great reverence. The Lord tried on all the different ornaments. There was such a wide variety of all shapes and designs of jewelry that one had never seen before. Gold ornaments studded with pearls, emeralds, rubies, the gold intricately worked upon to give exquisite designs. He wore beautiful rings on all his 10 fingers. Many brilliant necklaces of priceless gems decorated his neck and chest. Then, showing special favor to Lord Shiva, he slipped 2 Rudraksha necklaces around his neck. As he moved, the light set afire the gems set into his golden earrings. The silver anklets around his lotus feet tinkled pleasingly. White, cream, blue, and yellow silks draped him in flowing grace. An enchanting sight it was indeed. Devotees had lovingly made beautiful garlands of fragrant flowers like Malati, Malika, Yuti, and Champak, and now put them over his head to sit delicately on his chest with the rest of the shimmering gems. But with each motion, they swayed. The fragrance of these garlands mingled with the aroma of fresh sandalwood paste that was applied on his body and filled the air with a heavy, sweet scent. Soft, shining silks of different hues were tied around his head to make a multicolored turban. Bright flower garlands were also neatly placed on the turban to make a unique headgear. His happy face exuded irresistible glowing charm enough to overshadow the brilliance of a million moons. Smiling, he constantly chanted the Lord's name. His lotus-eyed glance roved the room and released in every heart the floodgate of love of Godhead. 2 iron rods that shone like silver stood on either side of his throne. He held one in his hand as Lord Balaram holds his plow. His associates, who were actually the expansions of the cowherd boys of Braja, took up different ornaments and instruments that decorate them as they go grazing the cows. They dressed themselves with armlets, belts, anklets, necklaces, tied horns, flutes, and reeds to their belts, and looped the rope for tying cows around their shoulders. Then Lord Nityananda went out with all his associates as if going to graze the cows. They visited the houses of all the Vaishnavas residing on both banks of the Ganga. Himself immersed in an ocean of ecstasy that was within himself, the Lord blessed everyone with his association. The people were helplessly drawn to him on sight, captivated by his power and beauty. He is the embodiment of all transcendental mellows, representing both the holy name and the supreme Godhead himself. Even the atheists and agnostics, upon seeing him, began to offer prayers to him, feeling an urge in their melted hearts to offer everything to him. The most munificent Lord showered causeless mercy upon all. Wherever he went, whatever he did, Lord Nityananda was constantly absorbed in Sankirtan. And when he began dancing and singing Kirtan, he sent everyone reeling in spirals of divine exaltation. Even the young children exhibited wonderful powers in his presence. Children from ordinary households manifested such strength that they uprooted big trees roaring loudly like thunderbolts. They said, "I am a cowherd boy," and ran about. Hundreds tried to hold these children, but failed to do so. This was such an extraordinary feat for a mere child. The children chanted jubilantly, "Sri Krishna Chaitanya, Jai Nityananda." A more wonderful phenomenon then came to light. The children had gone without food for an entire month. Everyone was amazed, so before they lost their minds, they prayed to Lord Nityananda and took shelter of him. The Lord looked after the children like a father. He fed them, actually putting food in their mouths. Sometimes he bound them, making them sit next to him. He would even beat them as a disciplinarian, and enjoying himself, he would laugh out loudly. One day, Lord Nityananda came to the house of Gadadhar Das, feeling great affection for him. Sri Gadadhar Das was always submerged in the ecstatic mood of the gopis of Braja. Lifting a water pot filled with Ganga water on his head, he would go around vending, "Who wants to buy cow's milk?" Such was his absorption in the mood of Braja. In his house, he worshipped a beautiful deity of Lord Balagopal Krishna. When Lord Nityananda came inside the house and saw the charming Balagopal deity, he immediately picked him up and held him to his chest. All the devotees began to chant Krishna's name loudly, and Lord Nityananda, roaring like a lion, began to dance. Sri Madhava Ghosh started singing. He was specially gifted with a very sweet voice, and so when his song described Krishna's pastimes of levying taxes on the gopis, Lord Nityananda was overwhelmed with a surge of divine emotions. Thus the Lord was engaged in ecstatic pastimes with the most fortunate Gadadhar Das, who never forgot for a moment that he was a gopi. The Lord continued to dance so gracefully that it is impossible to describe his lissome movements. He manifested all the ecstatic symptoms and the transformations of ecstatic emotion of love of Godhead. His movements were like flashes of lightning, yet charming and delicate. The expressions with his eyes and eyebrows were subtle, and he always kept a mild smile playing on his lips. The movements of his head were expertly done, like a seasoned classical dancer, knowing the correct nuances to express the various transcendental moods. Then, bringing his exquisite feet together, he began to jump with ease and flowing movements. He was the all-merciful Lord, so wherever he looked, all the men and women felt drawn into an ocean of indescribable bliss. Such was the impact of his benign glance that everyone lost all sense of time, body, and matter, and experienced only an overwhelming joy. The divine devotional bliss that Lord Nityananda showered on everyone without discrimination by his causeless mercy was the object of great value for very elevated yogis and sages. By his mercy, other miracles also came to be manifest. When a grown-up man as strong as an elephant has to fast for 3 days, he becomes weak. The children were fasting for a month, but now when they danced, they seemed to have more energy and stamina than a lion. And although Lord Nityananda manifested such miraculous powers, no one could understand how everything was happening due to the illusory potency of the Lord, Sri Krishna Chaitanya. Lord Nityananda spent a few days in Gadadhar Das's house, drowning everyone in an ocean of transcendental bliss. Gadadhar Das felt divine exhilaration. Forgetting the mundane surrounding, he constantly chanted and made everyone also chant, encouraging them tirelessly. In that same village lived a very tyrannical Muslim priest, or Qazi. He was strongly opposed to the congregational chanting of the holy names. Intoxicated with spiritual ecstasy, Gadadhar Das one night made his way to the Qazi's house. Everyone was mortally fearful of the Qazi, but Gadadhar Das this night strode fearlessly to his residence. Never once did he stop chanting as he entered the house. The Qazi's friends and family members stared speechless in disbelief at Gadadhar Das. Gadadhar Das said, "Where is that rascal Qazi? He had better chant Krishna's name or I will sever his head." The Qazi came charging in, fuming with rage, but seeing Gadadhar Das, he calmed himself. The Qazi inquired, "Why have you come here, Gadadhar Das?" Gadadhar Das replied, I have some things to discuss with you. Lord Chaitanya and Lord Nityananda have incarnated in this age and have inspired the entire world to chant Krishna's holy name. Only you remain to chant, so I have come to urge you to chant Lord Hari's name. The Lord's holy name is all auspicious and supremely beneficial, and I take responsibility for saving you from all sinful reactions if you simply chant. Although the Qazi was known to be very cruel, now he was speechless and stupefied. Then, smiling wanly, the Qazi said, "Listen, Gadadhar Das, tomorrow I will certainly comply with your request to chant Hari Hari, but tonight, please go home." As soon as Gadadhar Das heard Lord Hari's name from the Qazi's mouth, he became jubilant. He said, "Why wait for tomorrow? Just now you have taken the Lord's name, and now you are completely free from all sins and inauspiciousness." Saying this to the Qazi, Sri Gadadhar Das began to dance like a madman, clapping his hands. Then suddenly he turned around and left, leaving a surprised Qazi still staring after him. Gadadhar Das returned to his residence. Gadadhar Das was always absorbed in meditating on Lord Nityananda. He is counted among the foremost of Lord Chaitanya's associates. This Qazi was considered so evil that no saintly persons would come near him. In fact, they said his close proximity would contaminate anyone. Yet Gadadhar Das showed his mercy even to such a demoniac person as he. Gadadhar Das was able to make him temporarily forget his malicious ways and inspire him to take Krishna's holy name once. The truth is that one who is imbued with love of Krishna can never be attacked by snakes, tigers, or any wild beasts, or be burned by fire. The devotional surrender to Krishna, Lord Brahma strives for, and the intimate loving exchanges of the gopis of Vrindavan with Krishna were all manifest in the persons of Lord Nityananda's associates solely by the causeless mercy of Lord Nityananda. Therefore, all of you, my brothers, please serve the lotus feet of Lord Nityananda. By his infinite grace, one can attain the eternal shelter of Lord Chaitanya. A few days passed, and one day Lord Nityananda had the urge to see Mother Sachi. So he left the next day, journeying towards Navadweep with his associates. On the way, he came to a village called Kardaha. He went to the house of Purandara Pandit. The Lord felt such great ecstasy that he began to dance jubilantly. It is impossible to pin down his graceful and lithe movements. Purandara Pandit was also a great devotee who was already mad with love of Godhead. He climbed up a tree and began to roar loudly like a lion. Another devotee named Chaitanya Das had become so surcharged with spiritual ecstasy that he was oblivious of everything around him. He ran into the forest chasing away the wild beasts with his rumbling roars. Once he saw a tiger and jumped on his back. The tiger was helpless, unable to do anything. Such is the potency of Lord Krishna's mercy. He then picked up a huge python and placed it on his lap and began to play with it fearlessly as he had earlier played with the tiger. All these miracles were taking place by Lord Nityananda's mercy. Lord Nityananda is especially inclined and affectionate to his devotees. He makes them very subtly taste the highest devotional mellows that even Lord Brahma is hankering after. Sri Chaitanya Das was deep in ecstasy, totally forgetting himself. He continuously spoke his intimate thoughts. He remained in the water for several days without a trace of discomfort. All his movements in this moment were practically unnoticeable, almost like an inert being. His devotional ecstasies were too numerous and subtle to be described. Sri Chaitanya Das was truly a very surrendered devotee, just like the great Murari Pandit. Even if the breeze that has touched his body touches someone, he can immediately feel growing attachment for Lord Krishna. There are some who call themselves Chaitanya Das, or servant of Lord Chaitanya. But even in their dreams, they never glorify the Lord. Lord Chaitanya is the heart and soul of Advaita Acharya, and by the Lord's mercy and Advaita Acharya's loving devotion to the Lord, that Advaita Acharya is always situated in transcendence. All glory to Advaita Acharya, whose devotion to the Lord is exemplary, and he is supremely powerful due to the Lord's grace. The real devotees consider that this relationship between Lord Chaitanya and Advaita Acharya as his servitor has made Advaita Acharya great, whereas the pretender devotees think that such descriptions of Advaita Acharya wanes his glory. How can such reprobates keep names like servant of Lord Chaitanya and take shelter of Advaita Acharya? As for those who refer to these sinful reprobates as Advaita Acharya's followers, they also do not actually know the Acharya's heart. Their keeping names like Chaitanya Das is the same as when the demons keep names like Punyajan or pious person. Lord Nityananda stayed on in Kardaha for a few days and then left with his followers to the village of Saptagram. In this village, the famous seven sages performed severe austerities sitting on the bank of the Ganga and finally attained the lotus feet of Krishna, Govinda. This place is known throughout the universe as Triveni Ghat. The three most holy rivers, Ganga, Jamuna, and Saraswati, confluence at this spot. The mere act of seeing this place purifies one of all sins. Lord Nityananda and his associates bathed there, feeling sublime joy. From there they went to Uttaranadat's house, also situated on the banks of the Ganga, and sojourned for a few days. Sri Uttaranadat received the Lord with great love and reverence and worshipped him with all his heart, body, and words. In this way, Sri Uttaranadat inherited the transcendental fortune to serve Lord Nityananda, who is the Supreme Lord eternally, for his servitor, Sri Uttaranadat. And because of Sri Uttaranadat, the entire community of traders became purified. Of this there is no doubt. It was as if Lord Nityananda had advented specifically to deliver this community and elevate them to receive loving devotional service to the Supreme Lord. Lord Nityananda spent all his time going from one trader's house to another, performing congregational chanting of the holy name. The trader's families surrendered fully at the Lord's feet, taking his shelter. It was a rare and amazing sight to see how this inherently pound, shilling, and pence community responded so spontaneously to the process of pure devotional service to Lord Krishna. This clearly indicates the unlimited potency of Lord Nityananda, that he could imbue in this materialistic and ignorant community the urge for self-realization. The Lord tirelessly kept up an enthusiastic sankirtan with his associates as long as he stayed in Saptagram. His sankirtan pastimes here will take more than 1,000 years to fully describe. The blissful feelings that one experienced in sankirtan here in Saptagram reminded everyone of their ecstasy in Navadvip sankirtan. People and devotees were so surcharged with the holy names that they ignored eating and sleeping. The whole village resounded with the holy name. Lord Nityananda led the sankirtan to every home through all the streets and localities of Saptagram. And when the people beheld the Lord's dancing form, it was impossible for anyone to check himself from swooning in joy. What to speak of others, even a meat-eating Muslim, who generally do not believe in Lord Vishnu, Krishna, was moved to tears of ecstasy, so much so that a Brahmin derided himself for not being able to match his devotion. All glory to Lord Nityananda, whose mercy can make the impossible possible. The days in Saptagram passed amidst such miracles and ecstasy, and Lord Nityananda was its main actor. Lord Nityananda then traveled for a few days and came to Shantipur and went directly to his beloved compatriot, Advaita Acharya's house. Sri Advaita Acharya felt an indescribable pleasure spreading through his heart upon seeing Lord Nityananda. Roaring loudly, Hari, Hari, Sri Advaita offered repeated obeisances and circumambulated him. He encircled his arms around the Lord in a loving embrace and bathed him in his cascading tears of joy. Both of them were almost unconscious with overwhelming spiritual emotions as loving exchanges welled up in their hearts. They rolled in the courtyard, tight in each other's embrace, and then both tried to touch the other's feet. Each of them roared continuously like 1,000 lions, unable to contain their madness. Finally, after a long time, they sat down, quieting themselves. Advaita Acharya then folded his hands and began to pray to the Lord in sublime pleasure. He said, "Your transcendental form is saturated with eternal joy, hence you are named Nityananda. You are the embodiment of Lord Chaitanya's transcendental qualities. You are the cause of liberation of the conditioned souls. You are also the firm pillar of religion, unswayed by the destructive forces of total dissolution, the only shelter. You teach the science of love of Godhead, devotional service to Lord Chaitanya. You are truly the solid main trunk of the tree of Lord Chaitanya's family, possessing full spiritual potency. You are the supreme teacher of all devotees of the Lord, like Lord Brahma, Lord Shiva, Narada Muni, and so on. Although everyone can attain the platform of devotional service to the Supreme Lord only through your grace, yet you are not affected by pride in spite of this most elevated position. You are the deliverer of the most fallen souls, never scrutinizing anyone's faults. Thus only those who are endowed with volumes of piety are able to know you. You are personified supramundane knowledge. Anyone can extirpate nescience simply by remembering you. No one can know you as you are unless you personally reveal yourself. Transcendental qualities like freedom from anger and ever-blissfulness decorate your personality. You are the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the support and mainstay of Anantashesh and the other demigods. You are Sri Lakshman, the slayer of demons, and in Vrindavan you are Lord Haladhar or Baladev, the son of a gopi. You have appeared in this material world simply to deliver the wretched conditioned souls. The pure devotion that is so intensely desired by great mystic yogis and philosophers is readily given by you to anyone. Speaking eloquently in the Lord's praise, Sri Advaita felt an upsurge of great spiritual emotions, and he went into an ecstatic trance. Sri Advaita is one of the few who are fully aware of Lord Nityananda's real personality, for this knowledge is accessible to the meager few who possess sufficient spiritual insight. The arguments and verbal fights that are sometimes seen between Lord Nityananda and Sri Advaita are actually just mock, done in a spirit of deep camaraderie and affection for each other and not fathomable by all. Very few can comprehend the essence of Sri Advaita's words. He is non-different from the Supreme Lord. But now they spent intimate moments together discussing topics of Lord Krishna's pastimes. This increased their attachment and respect for each other. Lord Nityananda finally begged permission from Sri Advaita to leave and proceeded to Navadvip. On reaching Navadvip, Lord Nityananda first went to meet Mother Sachi. He offered obeisances at her feet. Mother Sachi was excessively happy to see Lord Nityananda. She said, "My dear, you are truly the super soul who knows everything. I was yearning to see you, and immediately you appear from nowhere. Who can know your true self? Now please stay in Navadvip for some time so I can see you once in every 10 days or so. I am miserable and I wanted to see you. You have come miraculously to wipe away my tears." Lord Nityananda smiled gently as he listened to Mother Sachi's words. Lord Nityananda was not confused about Sachimata's spiritual potency and position. He said, "Listen, Ayi, you are the Universal Mother. The purpose of my coming to Navadvip is to see you. I have also a strong desire for your transcendental association, and so now I will remain in Navadvip in accordance with your instructions." Thus presenting himself to Mother Sachi and addressing her in a befitting manner, the Lord went about Navadvip doing his business. Lord Nityananda gathered his associates and went to every house in Navadvip performing congregational chanting. He was in constant ecstasy as he did incessant sankirtan. The Lord dressed in a special and very attractive way that was a pleasurable sight. He wrapped many colored silk clothes around his head like a maharaj, and on top of this turban were strand after strand of flower garlands. His chest was covered with innumerable glittering necklaces of gold, pearls, and many studded gems. From his ears gently dangled golden earrings set with shiny white pearls. Bejeweled armlets and bracelets graced his hands and arms. His whole body was covered with countless jewelry of priceless value. Different parts of his body were exquisitely decorated with designs of sandalwood paste. Often he acted like Bala Gopal Krishna as a small fat toddler of Vrindavan. Sometimes he picked up an iron rod overcome with ecstatic emotions and held it with both hands, all his fingers decorated with golden rings. Multicolored silks draped all over him. Cane, flute, and horn were stuck in his belt with listlessness. His very sight captured the minds of the people. His gait was like that of a royal elephant. With every step, the silver ankle bells jangled musically. The Lord's transcendental glances immediately invoked spiritual love of Godhead wherever they rested. Lord Nityananda moved about in the town of Lord Chaitanya's birth with great pleasure, dressed in this wonderful fashion to give joy in the hearts of everyone. Navadvip was like the capital city of Mathura, teeming with people. Many pious people lived there. They were so religious that wretched sinners could become free from their sins just by seeing them. So also there were such abominable reprobates, that if their shadow touched anyone, he would become bereft of all his piety. All these people, whoever they were inspired on the path of pure Krishna consciousness by the mercy of Lord Nityananda. Lord Chaitanya had earlier liberated so many of these people, and now Lord Nityananda was purifying many others. He saved the thieves, rogues, derelicts, and wretches. Listen to the wonderful story of how Lord Nityananda saved the most fallen. In Navadweep lived a young Brahmin who was the biggest rogue and dacoit. Although born in a Brahmin family, he was an arsenal of all depraved habits and was the leader of the dacoits. He was brutally malicious and killed without feeling. He was always in the company of rogues. Once this dacoit leader saw Lord Nityananda bedecked with all the fineries and priceless jewels and gloated after this treasure, wanting to steal it all. So pretending to be a member of the Lord's Sankirtan party, the dacoit went along with the chanting party wherever they went. He was biding time for the right opportunity to steal everything. Lord Nityananda immediately knew his wicked intentions. The Lord, learning of this, left his party and went quietly to live in Hiranyapandit's house. Hiranyapandit was a very pious Brahmin and lived frugally, becoming of a true Brahmin. In the meanwhile, the dacoit leader called his men and chalked out a plan. He said, "My brothers, why should we worry any longer? Our protector, Goddess Chandi, has arranged for all the wealth to be in one place. This Avadhuta has on his person gold, gems, and jewelry worth lakhs of rupees. He is right now hiding in Hiranyapandit's house, which is in a secluded and lonely part of town. Collect your swords and shields, and we shall meet tonight and raid that house and loot everything." They dispersed quickly and quietly, eagerly waiting for night to descend when they could carry out their nefarious crime. That night, the dacoits with their weapons collected near the house where the Lord was residing. They sent a spy to get proper information. The Lord was then enjoying a sumptuous meal with all his associates, sitting around him and chanting loudly. The devotees were all submerged in the bliss of chanting Lord Krishna's holy name. Some roared jubilantly like thunderclaps, others wailed loudly in insatiable joy, and still others clapped their hands and laughed in peals. All around, the devotees were crying out loudly to express their childlike, unrestrained glee. They were all wide awake. The spy returned to his gang, informing them, "The Avadhuta is eating, and everyone else is wide awake and jubilant." So the dacoits decided that, "Let them eat and go to sleep, then we will attack the house." They made themselves comfortable under a tree and settled down to wait. They started talking amongst themselves, dreaming of their future fortunes. Someone said, "I want the gold bracelets." Another said, "I will take the pearl necklace." Another fancied, "The earrings are for me." Yet another dreamed, "I'll have the gold chains and necklaces." Someone else said, "But leave the silver ankle bells for me." And they went on daydreaming of enormous riches. Just then, by Lord Nityananda's desire, slumber overcame the whole dacoit gang. Right there, under the tree, the dacoits went into a deep sleep. Such was the workings of the Lord's divine potency that they slept through the night, undisturbed and almost in a state of unconsciousness. The crow's harsh cawing woke them up early the next morning. They became disheartened and frustrated to find that the night had passed. They collected their weapons, and keeping them in safe hiding, they went to the Ganga for their baths. After the bath, they began to blame each other. One of them accused the other, "You were the first to fall asleep." And he retorted, "So you were the one who stayed awake the whole night?" Someone tried to pacify them, saying, "Why do you have to fight like this? Be thankful that Goddess Chandi has saved us from total shame." The young Brahmin dacoit leader said, "Of what use are these arguments? Whatever has happened is due to Goddess Chandi's desire. The passing of one day is not the end of everything. I can understand that because we did not worship Mother Chandi before, she has deluded us all. Today, let us perform a grand Chandi worship with a lot of meat and wine." They eagerly collected the required ingredients and meat and wine and worshiped Goddess Chandi that night. The next day, the dacoits sharpened and cleaned their weapons. In the night, they came to Lord Nityananda's residence dressed in dark blue clothes. The residents of the house were already in deep slumber. Near the house, the dacoits saw that it was guarded by many sentries. The sentries were all well armed and were all loudly and continuously chanting the holy name as they walked about guarding the house. All of the sentries were giant-sized, able-bodied men. They carried many different weapons. The dacoits could easily make out that any one of the sentries could take on 100 of them alone. These sentries were not ordinary guards. They wore tilak marks on their foreheads and bodies and wore tulsi beads around their necks. They constantly chanted Lord Krishna's holy name while Lord Nityananda slept inside the house. The dacoits were taken by complete surprise. They slowly slouched to a distance away from the house and sat down. They wondered dejectedly, from where did these sentries come suddenly? One of them said, "The Avadhuta must have somehow known of our coming and he brought these sentries from somewhere." His friend replied, "This Avadhut person is very knowledgeable and is a seer. I have heard this from many people. He can certainly protect himself. The sentries that are on guard are all more formidable than normal sentries. They are almost superhuman. I suppose this is another display of his divine potency. No wonder they call him Goswami." Another interjected, "I think you are quite ignorant. For one who eats and wears such fancy ornaments, how can he be called a Goswami, controller of the senses?" Finally, the dacoit leader, the young Brahmin, spoke up saying, "I have calmly considered all the factors. I see that many powerful and influential people come to meet the Avadhut. These sentries must be the best soldiers of some powerful king come here to guard him. And these sentries, by his instance, become attracted to spiritual elevation. Hence, they also chant Hari, Hari. So as long as these sentries are here, we should stay away. I think after about 10 days, we can expect them gone. And then we can return. But now let us disperse quietly and go back to our houses." The dacoits stealthily left that place and were gone. Lord Nityananda, inside the house, continued to perform his pastimes unperturbed. Anyone can easily overcome all reverses just by remembering those souls who have taken full shelter of Lord Nityananda's lotus feet. Who can harm such an omnipotent supreme lord when simply by remembering his servitors one can surmount the insurmountable ocean of nescience? Lord Ganesh, the remover of all adverses, along with his associates, are Lord Nityananda's servants. The Lord's partial expansion, Rudra, Lord Shiva, is the destroyer of the entire material world. Another of the Lord's partial expansions, Lord Ananta, holds the cosmic manifestation on one of his hoods. If by chance he moves, there are terrible earthquakes. Who can make such a supremely powerful Lord fearful of anything or anyone? The Lord is moving about in Navadvip, freely performing ecstatic kirtans wherever he goes. Undisturbed, he eats, sleeps, and enacts his pastimes, his entire body still decorated with priceless gems and jewelry. He is Lord Baladev, the son of Rohini Devi. Chewing pan mixed with camphor, he smiles, enchanting the whole world. Fearless and with endless exuberance, the Lord, accompanied by his associates, roams everywhere. His devotees, too, were unassailed by any kind of anxiety. The dacoits made another attempt to lay siege to Lord Nityananda's residence. That night, by divine arrangement, the sky was overcast with black, billowing clouds that plunged the earth in pitch darkness. The streets were deserted. The dacoits held their weapons close to their bodies, feeling insecure in this sudden, terrible gloom. As they came close to the house, they were suddenly struck by blindness. They stumbled forward, groping as if in a dark abyss, their minds paralyzed, their intelligence unable to function. Some of them plunged into the moat surrounding the house and were immediately attacked by leeches, insects, and giant mosquitoes. Some of them lost their way into the refuse garbage pit and fell in. The insects and scorpions were unsparing and vicious. Some others walked straight into a bush of thorns and became completely entangled and bruised by the big, cruel thorns. Afraid to move in the dark and be further punctured, they remained like prisoners, unmoving. Others had veered far from the house and in the darkness, falling inside the canal near the house and lay moaning and groaning in pain with fractured legs and hands. Many dacoits began to feel suddenly very feverish. They began to slowly consider their plight. Just at this moment, Lord Indra, with great pleasure, sent down sheets of rain, accompanied by raging storms and ominous lightning. Already the dacoits were being ravaged by leeches, scorpions, and insects, and now they were being further inflicted by the merciless downpour. Then came the large pieces of hail, pounding them endlessly. Although the dacoits did not die, they were tossed about in an ocean of excruciating pain and misery. Blinded and drenched, they began to shiver with the clammy coldness, standing helpless against the fury of nature. Lord Indra, knowing that the dacoits had come to harm Lord Nityananda, became angry and punished them especially hard. After taking the punishment from the dacoit leader, the young Brahmin was suddenly struck by a thought. He reasoned in his mind, "This Nityananda is not immortal. He is certainly the Supreme Lord. The first time he put us in deep slumber, and I did not understand by his illusory potency. The next time it was these very strange and almost superhuman sentries, but even then I could not realize the truth. Hence, I deserve this misery, because I am such a sinful reprobate that I wanted to steal from the Lord his wealth. Yet now faced with this insurmountable danger, who can save me except Lord Nityananda himself?" Thinking in this manner, he began to meditate on Lord Nityananda's lotus feet, taking full shelter in him. The result of taking shelter and remembering the Lord's lotus feet is that such a person, even though the lowest of sinners, is immediately saved. The young Brahmin prayed, "You are the Supreme Lord, Balagopal. Please save me. Please protect me. You are the maintainer of all living entities. O Lord, a person who falls to the earth, his only shelter is Mother Earth herself. Similarly, one who commits offenses at your lotus feet can seek the only shelter, your lotus feet, by which all miseries are mitigated. And you are so merciful that you forgive all the offenses of the most wretched living entities. I am the black sheep and destroyer of the Brahmin society, a slayer of cows. There is no one more degraded than myself. Yet it is also true that even if the most sinful person prays for your shelter, then he can become free from this material imprisonment. O Lord, you sustain all the living entities throughout their lives, and at the end only you are there to protect them. So Lord, please save me today from this predicament, and if I remain alive, then I have certainly learned my lesson. I only desire that I can have you birth after birth as my Lord and Master, and I your eternal slave." Lord Nityananda is the most munificent Supreme Lord. When he heard the piteous prayers of the dacoit leader, he immediately alleviated their misery. Suddenly, the dacoits found themselves able to see again. By the Lord's divine powers, the storm and gale did not afflict them further. Gradually, they began to move and walk as if they had risen from their graves. They returned to their individual houses and right away bathed in the purifying waters of the Ganga. The dacoit leader had different feelings. He began to weep incessantly. He did not go anywhere, but went inside the house, wanting to meet and throw himself at the Lord's feet. Inside, the Lord of the Universe, Lord Nityananda, was sitting and glancing benignly at all the miserable conditioned souls. The devotees all around him were chanting loudly, and the Lord himself roared like thunder with divine bliss. At this moment, the dacoit leader entered into the Lord's presence. He threw his arms in the sky, and crying out, "Save me," he threw himself down before the Lord. His whole body quivered, and the hair on his body stood on end as tears flowed out in streams. Totally absorbed in sublime ecstasy, he became oblivious of everything around him, and he roared like a lion, unable to stop the surge of divine emotions. Such was the spiritual influence of Lord Nityananda that the Brahmin began to suddenly dance with his arms raised high, chuckling in irrepressible glee. He sang continuously, "O Lord Nityananda, Savior of the fallen souls, you are my only master." The devotees and the other people assembled there were astounded at this sight. They exclaimed, "What a miraculous transformation from a deadly dacoit to this condition." The more cautious ones said, "Maybe this is just a trick. Suddenly, he will start his real business of looting." Others said, "Our Lord Nityananda is the savior of the most abominable sinners. By his mercy, this reprobate has been transformed." Lord Nityananda, seeing this display of extreme spiritual emotions, smiled and said, "O Brahmin, please explain the reason for your present behavior. I have noticed some wonderful expressions in you. What have you seen or heard relating to Lord Krishna that has prompted you to act in this manner? Tell us everything without being constrained." The fortunate Brahmin remained dumbfounded for some time, hearing the Lord's words. Only unrestricted tears flowed freely from his eyes. He then rolled on the ground and sometimes cried loudly, sometimes laughed out loudly, then suddenly springing up, he began to dance and sing, All his actions were spontaneous and natural. The Brahmin calmed himself after a while and began to speak in the Lord's presence. He said, O Lord, I am a resident of Navadweep and a Brahmin in name only. Actually, my demeanor is that of the lowest caste of Chandalas or dog eaters. My nature is as vicious as a hunter's. From my early days, I have always been in the company of thieves and dacoits. Hence, I know only violence, hate, and murder. The residents of Navadweep shake in fear at my sight, and there is not a sin left that I have not committed. When I saw your beautiful ornaments, I wanted to steal them. So one night I gathered my dacoit gang and came to loot those jewelries from your transcendental body. But that night you put every one of us into a deep slumber. Yet by your illusory potency, I could not understand your hand behind this extraordinary phenomenon. A few days later, we made another attempt. This time we had properly worshipped Goddess Chandi and then came with well-oiled and sharpened weapons. Yet another miraculous aided us. We saw your house surrounded by tall and stout guards marching about, chanting the holy name loudly. All of them were wearing long garlands reaching down to the knees. You were safe and unperturbed sleeping inside the house. We are so wretched that even then we could not recognize your divine status. Disgruntled, we muttered, Who knows where these sentries have come from? And then shuffled away to our houses. Before our third attempt, we waited for quite a few days. Then yesterday we came, and instantly upon arrival, we lost our vision. We stumbled into the compound of this house, unable to properly see, and fell into ditches and thorny bushes. The storm, hail, and rains mercilessly us, but we were helpless against them. After we had gone through hellish punishment and pain, everyone gradually became enlightened about the boundless mercy of the Lord. By your grace, we began to remember your lotus feet. Our sight returned and we were able to see in the true sense. Such is your causeless mercy. Hence, you are the savior of the most fallen souls. You are so magnanimous that simply by thinking of you, I was let free from the hellish distress. Anyone can factually enter the spiritual world, extirpating the nescience within, just meditating on you. Speaking in this manner, the Brahmin began to cry and dance with raised, flaying hands. Such are the super excellent pastimes of the Supreme Lord Nityananda. The assembled devotees were astounded hearing the Brahmin speak, and they felt great regard for him and offered him respect. The Brahmin began speaking once more. O Lord, now I beg permission to leave. I have no desire to maintain this body any further. As I have nurtured malicious intent in my heart towards you, I must repent. I will cast this useless body into the Ganga and finish my life. The Lord and the devotees were moved by the Brahmin's sincerity. The Lord then replied, O Brahmin, you are truly a very fortunate soul. You are an elevated servitor of Lord Krishna. How is it otherwise possible for you to witness this miracle? Because you are the recipient of the Lord's mercy and his beloved servant. The Supreme Lord Chaitanya has advented to save the most fallen souls. Of this there is no doubt. Now listen carefully, O Brahmin. From this moment, if you give up your ghastly sinful activities, then I am willing to take responsibility for all your previous misdeeds. No more aggression, violence, looting, or murder. Forever get rid of them. Practice religious life and chant the holy names of the Supreme Lord. Then later, you can also save others. Go and meet other dacoits and murderers and bring them to the path of pure religious living. The Lord then took the garland from his neck and placed it over the Brahmin's head, being very pleased with him. The air was resounding with the devotees' jubilant cheers of the holy name. The shackles of material nescience broke away from the Brahmin. The Brahmin threw himself at the Lord's feet and, grasping tightly, he began calling out his name again and again. Tears streaked down his cheeks. He cried out, O Lord Nityananda, you are the savior of lost souls. Please allow this wretch a little place at your lotus feet. I was so abominable that I was malicious to you, and so there is no place for me to go. Lord Nityananda is an ocean of compassion. He placed his lotus feet on the Brahmin's head. The Brahmin became instantly purified of all offenses. Later, this converted dacoit brought many others to take shelter of Lord Chaitanya by chanting and leading a pure life. All of them discarded their old bad ways of looting and murder and began to behave gently. They were chanting lakhs of holy names, and soon became experienced and fixed in devotional service to the Supreme Lord. They absorbed themselves all the time in singing the pastimes of Lord Krishna with divine love. Such is the magnanimity of Lord Nityananda. In none of the previous incarnations was the Supreme Lord so compassionate as Lord Nityananda. Lord Nityananda gives liberation and love of God instantly to the conditioned souls. Hence, if anyone, even an elevated Brahmin, disregards Lord Nityananda, then such a person is degraded to the level of dacoits and murderers. The ecstatic symptoms of love of Godhead, which are so intensely desired by the master yogis who want to experience crying, shivering, horripilation, and other such spiritual emotions, is now made easily available to rogues and thieves by the wonderful divine potency of Lord Nityananda. Therefore, all of you, please worship such a merciful Lord Nityananda. By his grace, one can attain the shelter of Lord Gaurachandra. One who hears Lord Nityananda's pastimes will indeed reach Lord Chaitanya. And one who hears properly this story of the deliverance of the dacoits is assured to see face to face both Lord Nityananda and Lord Chaitanya. In this way, Lord Nityananda performs his pastimes undisturbed and with great pleasure. Lord Nityananda went daily on congregational chanting to different villages all over Nadia with his associates. He visited Kanchanda, Badagachi, Dogachia, and sometimes they crossed to the other side of the Ganga to Kulia village. Badagachi village folk were especially fortunate because of their piety. Lord Nityananda spent a lot of time there. One cannot gauge the amount of blessings the residents of Badagachi received. Lord Nityananda was always in very blissful spirits. They had no other business than chanting and dancing and accompanying the Lord as he went everywhere. Steadily, the mood of Vrindavan cowherd boys increased in them. They were now always dressed as cowherd boys with cow horns, flutes, and strings for tying the calves, wearing garlands of gunja flowers around the neck, a metal bangle on the wrist, and small foot bells around the ankles. They constantly exhibited sublime ecstasy, sometimes crying, sometimes shivering, and again at times horripilating in love of Lord Krishna. Each one's beauty blossomed to match Cupid's good looks as they joined in the congregational chanting. With an inspiring and fearless master like Lord Nityananda always leading them, the devotees were submerged in divine exhilaration. The transcendental excellences of the Lord's associates are so limitless that even in 1,000 years I will be unsuccessful in fully describing them. Yet I must still mention the names of as many associates as I can remember and try to describe their glories. Just by recollecting the names of Lord Nityananda's associates, a person can transcend this material existence. All these associates are incarnations of the family members of Nanda Maharaj of Braja. They are cowherd boys and damsels from Lord Krishna's pastimes in Vrindavan. Lord Nityananda has specifically instructed his associates not to mention their previous names and identities. Sri Ramdas Mahashai is a very great devotee of Lord Nityananda. He spoke from a transcendental level as if the Supreme Lord were himself speaking. Nobody could fathom his words. He carried Lord Nityananda always in his heart. Sri Ramdas was considered amongst the associates as the most feeling devotee submerged in ecstatic thoughts. Lord Krishna, on a particular occasion, entered his body for 3 months. Murari Gupta is famous as Lord Chaitanya's intimate servitor. He was so fearless that he actually played with a tiger and a snake. Sri Raghunath Upadhyaya, an Ayurvedic doctor, was a pure devotee, and by his mere glance, he invoked devotional attraction for Lord Krishna in others. Sri Gadadhar Das was always tasting the transcendental nectar of divine mellows. The very sight of him cleansed others of all sinful reactions. Sri Sundarananda was like an ocean of devotional ambrosia. He was one of the foremost of the Lord's associates. Sri Kamalakanta Pandit was at every moment exuberant in devotional service. Lord Nityananda gave him the village of Saptagram. Sri Goridas Pandit is a most fortunate soul. He served Lord Nityananda with his body, mind, and words. Indeed, the Lord was his very life. Sri Purandara Pandit was extremely peaceful and grave, always experiencing divine ecstasy in the Lord's association. Lord Nityananda is also the life and soul of Sri Parameshwari Thakur. The Lord, being especially inclined towards him, is always present in his body. Sri Dhananjaya Pandit was a stalwart preacher of Bhagavad Dharma, and so Lord Nityananda made his permanent residence in his heart. Sri Balaram Das was always absorbed in loving devotional service. Anyone in his presence became free from all sinful reactions. Sri Yadunath Kavi Chandra was incessantly swimming in a nectarian ocean of love of Godhead. His constant guide and shelter was Lord Nityananda. Sri Jagadish Pandit emanated spiritual brilliance everywhere he went. Lord Nityananda was his prime source of divine inspiration. Sri Purushottama Pandit appeared in Navadweep. He was fully surrendered at the lotus feet of Lord Nityananda. In his earliest pastimes, Lord Nityananda stayed in his house. By his mercy, one is drawn to the divine lotus feet of Lord Nityananda. Sri Dwija Krishnadas appeared in the Radha district in Bengal, as did Lord Nityananda. He is amongst the foremost of the Lord's eternal associates. Sri Kaliya Krishnadas is famous in all the three worlds. Simply by remembering him, one attains the association of Lord Chaitanya. Sri Sadashiva Kaviraj was also a very blessed personality. The glorious Purushottama Das was his son. Sri Purushottama Das was always in deep meditation, oblivious to his own body and surroundings. Lord Nityananda is forever situated within his heart. Sri Uddharana Dat was a very magnanimous Vaishnav who was especially qualified to render direct service to Lord Nityananda. Sri Mahesh Pandit and Paramananda Upadhyaya are stalwart Vaishnav devotees of the Lord, grave and compassionate. Sri Gangadas, son of Chaturbhuj Pandit, also received the Lord's special mercy because the Lord stayed in his house. Acharya Vaishnavananda was a very magnanimous soul. Previously, he was famous by the name of Sri Raghunath Puri. Sri Paramananda Gupta was a very eminent person. Lord Nityananda also spent a long time staying in his house. The pious Sri Krishnadas, who lived in Bhadagachi, was another very fortunate soul. Nityananda also stayed with him. Sri Krishnadas, Sri Devananda, and the spiritual instructor Acharya Chandra were all very elevated and pure Vaishnavas, whose only attraction was the lotus feet of Lord Nityananda. The two brothers, Sri Madhavananda Ghosh and Sri Vasudev Ghosh, were famous for their nectarian singing. They constantly relished spiritual mellows. Sri Jiva Pandit was the recipient of the Lord's special mercy. The Lord had stayed in his house. Then there were the four who were very dear to Lord Nityananda. They were Sri Manohar, Sri Narayan, Sri Krishnadas, and Sri Devananda. In 1,000 years, I would not be able to enumerate the names of all the servitors and associates of Lord Nityananda. The hundreds and thousands of devotees were all heart and soul surrendered to Lord Chaitanya and Lord Nityananda. By receiving Lord Nityananda's mercy, his associates are all spiritual guides for the whole world. They constantly meditated on Lord Chaitanya. I have but mentioned only a few who I know personally. Later, Vedavyas will reveal more divine personalities. The last of Lord Nityananda's servitors is Brindavan Das, the author. He was conceived in the womb of Srimati Narayani, who had received the remnants of Lord Chaitanya's foodstuff. Even today, the Vaishnavas glorify her as the one who ate Lord Chaitanya's remnants, which was recognized as a rare blessing. Lord Sri Krishna Chaitanya and Lord Nityananda are my life and soul. I, Brindavan Das, humbly offer this song at their divine lotus feet.